As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah wa alhamdulillah. Wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah. Wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa ghidwana wa ba'd. In today's session we continue with the ahadith that are present within the Arba'een al-Nawawiyyah of Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullahu ta'ala. And as we've said, then we iterate these 40 hadith are some of the most important of the ahadith that Imam al-Nawawi collected to formulate principles from the principles of the religion. In fact, Imam al-Nawawi, he held that these hadith were ahadith that the religion revolves around. In today's session, we will look at the 10th hadith from the Arba'een. That is the hadith of Abi Huraira, radiallahu anhu, wherein Imam al-Nawawi, rahimahullahu ta'ala, he mentions عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله طيب. This hadith is a popular hadith from the important ahadith that Imam al-Nawawi mentions, and it is from the ahadith that deal with and discuss the affairs of halal and haram and the effect the halal and haram upon the believer. Abi Huraira radiallahu anhu, he said that the Messenger of Allah said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ طَيِّبْ لَا يَقْبَلُ إِلَّا طَيِّبًا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ أَمَرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ بِمَا أَمَرَ بِهِ الْمُرْسَلِينَ فَقَالَ تَعَالَى يَا أَيُّهَا الرُّسُلُ كُلُوا مِنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَأَعْمَلُوا صَالِحًا وَقَالَ تَعَالَى يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُلُوا مِنْ طَيِّبَاتِ مَا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ ثم ذكر الرجل يطيل السفر أشأث أغبر يمد يديه إلى السماء يا رب يا رب ومطعمه حرام ومشربه حرام وملبسه حرام وغذي بالحرام فأنى يستجاب له. رضي الله عنه أبو هريرة informs us, said that Allah عز وجل والله تعالى, he said, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is tayyib. And he does not accept other than that which is tayyib. And indeed Allah azza wa jalla has commanded the mu'mineen with that which he has commanded the mursaleen, with that which he has commanded the prophets and the messengers. For indeed Allah azza wa jalla has said, يَا أَيُّهَا الرُّسُلُ كُلُوا مِنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَعَمَلُوا صَالِحًا. O Prophet, or O Messenger, eat from that which is good and work righteous deeds. And Allah Azza wa Jalla has said, O ye who believe, ya ayyuha allazina amanu, kulu min tayyibati ma razaqnakum. O ye who believe, eat from the good things that we have provided for you. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned the affair of a man, yuqilu safar, a man that is upon a lengthy journey. أَشْأَثَ أَغْبَرْ, the Prophet ﷺ described him as being dusty and disheveled. يَمُدُّ يَدَيْهِ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ, he raises his hands to the sky, saying, يَا رَبْ, يَا رَبْ, saying, oh my Lord, oh my Lord. That is, he makes dua, supplicates to Allah Azza wa Jal. And the Prophet ﷺ went on to describe a further affair related to his issue. وَمَطْعَمُهُ حَرَامٌ, but his food is haram. وَمَشْرَبُهُ حَرَامٌ, and his drink is haram. وَغُذِّيَ بِالْحَرَامِ, and he is nourished by way of haram. فَأَنَّا يُسْتَجَابُ لَهُ, Rasulullah said at the end of the hadith. So how then does he expect to be answered? No doubt, a tremendous hadith, ayyuhal ikhwa, from the ahadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and in particular, a hadith that revolves around consuming that which is halal, refraining from the haram, and generally being upon that which is tayyib, generally being upon that which is good and that which is pure. Allah Azza wa Jalla in the hadith, Qudsi, or rather from the Prophet describing Allah Azza wa Jalla, he said that Allah is tayyib. And as far as the term tayyib here in relation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, So the term tayyib in relation to Allah Azza wa Jal is that Allah Azza wa Jal is to be raised above, and impurities and deficiencies are to be removed from Allah Azza wa Jal. We do not attribute anything from deficiency to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are a number of his names that carry that meaning, like As-Salam, Al-Mu'min. These names, Al-Quddus, these names are from the names of Allah that refer to Allah Azza wa Jal as being pure, as being perfect, as being free from all imperfections. And Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't have children and has no need for his creation. These are some of the meanings of these most beautiful names. And the Prophet ﷺ referring to Allah as being tayyib here returns back to the same meaning, that Allah is pure, Allah is to be freed from any imperfection attributed to him, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made mention of that throughout the Quran. For example, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions, وَقَالَ اتَّخَذَ الرَّحْمَنُ وَلَدًا, and they say that Ar-Rahman has taken a son, as it says in Surah Maryam, لَقَدْ جِئْتُمْ شَيْئًا إِدَّا. Allah mentions that indeed you have brought something tremendous. تَكَادُ السَّمَاوَاتُ يَتَفَطَّرْنَ مِنْهُ وَتَنْشَقُّ الْأَرْضِ وَتَخِرُّ الْجِبَالُ حَدَّا. Allah mentions that indeed the samawat, the heavens, are close to be splitting because of it, and the earth cleft asunder, and the jibal, the mountains, turn to dust, that they should claim that Ar-Rahman has a son. وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لِلرَّحْمَانِ أَنْ يَتَّخِذَ وَلَدًا, and it is not befitting that Ar-Rahman has a son, or to attribute a son to Ar-Rahman. Allah Azza wa Jal is far removed of having any need for anything from his creation. Our ibadat and our acts of worship do not benefit Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah Azza wa Jal is not in need of anyone's worship. That is something that is imperative that we understand. Allah removed from himself numerous imperfections that the creation attribute to him. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَظْلِمُ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ. Allah has mentioned that indeed Allah does not oppress even an atom's weight. Similarly, you will be familiar with Ayat al-Kursi, wherein Allah Azza wa Jal has mentioned لَا تَأْخُذُهُ سِنَةٌ وَلَا نَوْمٌ, that sleep or slumber does not overcome him. And so Allah Azza wa Jal removes from himself every form of imperfection and impurity. Indeed, Allah Azza wa Jal is tayyib. And so the Prophet ﷺ, he went on to mention, لا يقبل إلا طيبا, and Allah does not accept other than that which is tayyib. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, since oftentimes we hear the people returning the affair of the acceptance of righteous deeds back to Niyyah, when his Niyyah was good, he had good intention, yahi. That is not sufficient in the affair of the acceptability of the action. The act must be tayyib. And for an act to be accepted, then it must fulfill two conditions. First of those conditions is that it is performed sincerely for the sake of Allah, that it has ikhlas and sincerity, and that is where the niyyah comes into play. Yani that he intended Allah Azza wa Jal by way of it, and he performed the action purely for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. And secondly, that the act is in accordance with the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So there is nothing from the affairs that are considered hadith, nothing evil present within the action. And numerous ahadith establish the fact that the issue and the affair of the acceptability of any action returns back to that action fulfilling these conditions. Sometimes in the Sharia, we have the statement qubool, or that which is related to qabool and acceptability of the action, sometimes we have the origin in relation to Allah not accepting a particular action is that it is not accepted absolutely. That is the origin. And the Prophet ﷺ says, Allah will not accept such and such. For example, the statement of the Prophet ﷺ, لَا يَقْبَلُ اللَّهُ صَلَاةَ أَحَدِكُمْ إِلَىٰ أَحْدَثَ حَتَّى يَتَوَضَّعَ. That Allah Azza wa Jalla will not accept the action of the salah of one of you, إِلَىٰ أَحْدَثَ, if he breaks his wudu, حَتَّى يَتَوَضَّعَ, until he makes wudu. If he urinates, defecates, and he breaks wind, then his prayer, as goodly intended as he may be, his prayer is not accepted until he makes wudu, until he fulfills the conditions for the acceptability of that action. But on occasions, the affair may be mentioned by the Prophet ﷺ, and what is intended by way of it is that the reward is not established, though the fulfillment of the wajib may be present. That the reward is not established, but the fulfillment of the wajib may be present. That is, for example, the statement of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, in the Prophet ﷺ, he said, لا تقبل صلاة لامرأة تتطيب لهذا المسجد حتى ترجع فتغتسل غسلها من الجنابة. He said that indeed Allah Azza wa Jal will not accept the prayer of a woman who perfumes herself for the masjid until she returns and makes ghusl, the ghusl that she makes for janaba, the ghusl that she makes when she has sexual impurity. So here, the people of knowledge mention that this command or this affair of her salah not being accepted, that is, the ajr and the reward is not afforded to her. Though, if she performs the prayer, then she's fulfilled the wajib. But she's not rewarded for it because of her state. And that then is something to be observed in relation to the affair of Qabool. But whenever we find the statement that Allah will not accept, then the origin and the asl is that Allah Azza wa Jal will not accept. Allah will not accept. And it ordinarily returns back to the fact that the issue that was mentioned within the hadith is a condition from the conditions of the action. Therefore, if the condition is not present, then the action is not complete. Similarly, for example, we have the statement of the Prophet sallam, لا يقبل الله صلاة بغير الطهور ولا صدقة من غلول. That Allah Azza wa Jalla will not accept the prayer without tahara. That is, if a person makes the salah, he must establish and have tahara. Then the Prophet ﷺ mentioned, وَلَا صَدَقَةً مِنْ غُلُولٍ مِنْ غَلُولٍ لَا صَدَقَةً مِنْ غُلُولٍ. And neither will Allah Azza wa Jalla accept sadaqah from ghulul. And ghulul is a reference to wealth that is taken from the spoils of war without the permission of the imam. That is, an army, a battalion has entered a city, they have had a military expedition against an enemy, for example, and they were victorious, and then we have spoils of war, namely the possessions of those who they conquered. It is not permissible for those soldiers to now take whatever they please because we've now conquered these people. Rather, the origin is that the wealth of those people are collected and they are distributed in accordance with the dictates of the imam. That is the origin. But to steal from the spoils of war, to take from the spoils of war, even if it is just, for example, the sword of one's enemy, a person entered into a battle, he conquered an individual, or he killed one of the combatants, and so he takes his sword, he has a nice sword. It's haram, and it is a kabira min kabair al-dunub. It is a major sin from the major sins, and it is known as al-ghulul. It is known as al-ghulul. Prophet ﷺ, in this hadith, he said that Allah Azza wa Jal will not accept salah without tuhur, without purification. Neither will he accept sadaqah min ghulul. Neither will he accept sadaqah from that which is stolen from or taken from the spoils of war. The people of Mali, they mentioned that that is a clear text that indicates the fact that Allah Azza wa Jal will not accept sadaqah from that which is haram in its origin. And that it has, without doubt, a connection to the hadith that we're discussing here, that the origin in relation to that which a person consumes, that he eats and drinks and he feeds his family, the origin in relation to that which is given in sadaqah is that it must come from that which is tayyib. Why? And this is why, ikhwan, it is imperative that we do not fall prey to some of the doubts and the shubuhat that we hear the people of the hawa, desires, and the people who follow their sahwa. We hear them saying, yahi, in our time, it's impossible to live halal. Yahi, you have to bend the rules slightly. Yahi, the oppression that we're facing, you have to carry out what is haram. Or you have to do something that is not possible to be purely halal. And that, no doubt, is a siriyah, and it is a doubt and a shubha that the people of desires and the people who are not concerned with making sure that that which they seek from sustenance is halal, that they seek an easy route, those individuals, ikhwan, will justify that with these types of excuses. Yahi, you can't do it in this time. Difficult. And so here the Prophet ﷺ, we analyze the real meaning of the hadith. It should strike fear in our hearts in relation to our earnings and in relation to that which we feed our families with. And if it is that you're not the breadwinner, i.e. you're a sister, you're a wife, but you know that your husband is feeding the family with that which is haram, then it is your duty to give him nasiha. It is your duty to advise. It is your duty to carry out that which the Prophet ﷺ informed us of in one of the ahadith that we've mentioned previously, Ad-Din al-Nasiha, hadith of Tamim al-Dari. And so, in this hadith, then the Prophet ﷺ mentioned a number of realities. From those affairs is the importance of eating that which is halal, as we've mentioned here. And that was the way of the prophets and the messengers. And from them were those who were carpenters. From them were those who had professions and or trade. And here we find the Prophet ﷺ mentioning that Allah commanded the general believers with that which the prophets and messengers were commanded with. They eat what is tayyib. And this affair of eating tayyib encompasses, number one, the wealth that we earn, and number two, the actual food that we eat. And thus the affair of the foods that are halal and the foods that are haram, return back to this principle. Anything that Allah Azza wa Jal has made halal, it is halal because it is tayyib. And everything that Allah Azza wa Jal has made haram, it is haram because it is not tayyib. And that is important, ikhwan, for us to know. For indeed Allah commands with what is good. Al-Imam Sa'di, rahimahullah ta'ala, the teacher and sheikh of Al-Imam al-Sheikh bin Uthaymeen, he mentioned this general principle. That is that Allah Azza wa Jal is an important principle and a beneficial principle when we're giving da'wah. Whenever we're asked about something and we don't know the wisdom behind why such and such a thing is prohibited, then we have this general principle that we return back to. That is that Allah Azza wa Jal, إِنَّ اللَّهَ هَذِهِ said in his kitab, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَالْإِيْتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْسَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَالْبَغِي. That indeed Allah commands with al-ihsan. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْجَسْتِسِ and ihsan and benevolence and joining the bonds of kinship. And he prohibits al-fahsha, lewdness, and munkar, evil, and baghi, and transgression. But whenever we have an issue that we don't know why it has been prohibited, we can return individuals back to these general principles that Allah Azza wa Jalla does not command except with that which has been good, that which is khayr, that which has been adl, and that which is tayyib, and that which is upright. And he does not prohibit except from sin, and from transgression, and from evil, and from baghi, and oppression, and from that which is khabith, and that which is foul. And thus, the effect of the halal and haram returns back to this. That which is foul, Allah Azza wa Jal has prohibited us from it and made it haram. Whether we realize that or not, whether we love the taste or not, Allah Azza wa Jal has prohibited us from that which is bad for us. And that affair, without doubt, yani the affair of eating and consuming food, is from the affairs that we find the prophets and the messengers understood clearly. For indeed, when the Yahud came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to ask him a number of questions to test whether or not he was a prophet, to ask him questions that only a prophet would know, they asked him concerning Ya'qub, whose name is also Israel. They said, what was the food that Israel or that Ya'qub made haram upon himself? For indeed Allah Azza wa Jalla has mentioned in the Quran, كُلُّ الطَّعَامِ كَانَ هِلًّا لِبَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ إِلَّا مَا حَرَّمَ إِسْرَائِيلَ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَن تُنَزَّلَ التَّوْرَاتِ. Allah mentions that indeed all food was halal upon Bani Israel, other than the food that Israel, meaning here Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam, other than that which Israel made haram upon himself. So they asked the Messenger of Allah, what was the food that Ya'qub made haram upon himself? And so the Prophet responded that it was the meat of the camel and its milk. And that was, he went on to explain, that Ya'qub suffered from sciatica. He was taken by sciatica, which is a pain that usually starts from the back and runs down one of the legs. And it is a nervous condition. He suffered from sciatica, and he found nothing to blame other than the meat of the camel and its milk that he had previously consumed. And so he made camel's meat haram upon himself and milk, because of the fact that he held that it was his consumption of them that caused his ailment. And what we have in the hadith, as the people of knowledge mention, what we have in the hadith is the fact that the prophets and the messengers, they understood that diet is responsible for many of the ailments that we suffer from. Bad diet and not eating correctly. And so the prophets and the messengers, they understood the importance of eating tayyib. Allah Azza wa Jalla commanded them with it, and the believers are likewise commanded with it. And so in the hadith, the Prophet mentioned at the end of the hadith, an important qissah, an important story. And that is the affair of a man, yuqil as-safar, a man who had journeyed upon a long journey. Ash'asa aghbar. The Prophet ﷺ described him as being Ash'as and أغبر, يعني that he was dusty and disheveled, indicating the difficulties that he had faced upon his journey. يمد يديه إلى السماء, he raised his hands to the sky. يَا رَبْ, saying, O my Lord, O my Lord. Here, the Prophet ﷺ described a man making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while in a situation where he is in need of Allah azza wa jalla responding to him. He's on a journey, dusty and disheveled, and so he asks Allah azza wa jalla. There is an important benefit that the people of knowledge mention, and that is present within this hadith. That is that here we have the affair of a man who was upon a journey, who makes dua. And when we look at his state, we see that he was in the best, or he had the best combination of causes for the dua to be accepted. The best combination of causes by way of which the dua is accepted. And we see a number of the adab of the dua, the accepted dua present upon him. From those affairs, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that he was upon a safar. He was upon a journey. And I'm sure you'll be familiar with the fact that the dua of the person who's upon the journey is accepted. Prophet ﷺ, he said, ثَلَاثُ دَعْوَاتِ مُسْتَجَابَاتِ لَا شَكَّ فِيهِنْ. He said there are three du'as that are accepted without doubt. دَعْوَةُ الْمَظْلُومِ, the dua of the one who is oppressed. وَدَعْوَةُ الْمُسَافِرِ, and the dua or the dua of the one who is upon a journey. وَدَعْوَةُ الْوَلَدِ, وَدَعْوَةُ الْوَالِدُ لِوَلَدِهِ, and the dua of the walid, yani of the parent, for his son, or for his child. And so we see that the dua of the person who is upon a journey is from the du'as that are accepted. Similarly, the state of the individual, ash'atha aghbar, which is from the states that the Prophet ﷺ indicated, yani from the states of the individual whose du'a accepted, he indicated in a hadith, that this type of individual, his du'a is oftentimes accepted, and that is oftentimes because of the sincerity that is present within these types of individuals who are in difficulty. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi said, رُبَّ أَسْرَةٌ أَغْبَرْ مَدْفُوعٌ بِالْأَبْوَابِ لَوْ أَقْسَمَ عَلَى اللَّهِ لَأَبَرَّ, that it is possible that a person who is dusty and disheveled and pushed away from the doorways, and he knocks the door, somebody opens the door, sees him in his state, pushes him away, beggar, dusty and dirty and disheveled, so shoos him away from the door. Prophet ﷺ, he said, رُبَّ أَسْعَثَ أَغْبَرْ مَدْفُوعٌ بِالْأَبْوَابِ لَوْ أَقْسَمَ عَلَى اللَّهِ لَأَبَرَّ. Disheveled and shooed away from the doorways, if he were to swear by Allah, or if he were to take an oath by Allah, that is here, that he supplicates, and he makes an oath in that supplication, asking Allah Azza wa Jal from his bounty, then Allah Azza wa Jal will fulfill his dua. And so number two, he is dusty and disheveled. Number three, the Prophet ﷺ said, يَمُدُّ يَدَيْهِ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ, he raises his hands to the sky. And there is no doubt that this is from the types of states we're in, or from the conditions and from the scenarios wherein a person du'a is more likely to be accepted, that he raises his hands to Allah Azza wa Jal. Prophet ﷺ said, indeed Allah is Hayy. Hayyun Kareem. إِذَا رَفَعَ الرَّجُلُ إِلَيْهِ يَدَيْهِ أَنْ يَرُدَّ. Allah Azza wa Jal is Hayy, and He is Kareem, noble. He yastahi. Allah Azza wa Jal has istihya, that and istihya is ordinarily translated as shyness. But naturally, in relation to Allah Azza wa Jal, then we understand that we leave the name as it occurs, and we understand that it is understood in accordance with His, with that which befits His might and majesty. Here the Prophet ﷺ said, he has istihya, that his servant should raise his hands to the sky, and yaruddahuma sifran khaibatain, that he should turn his hands back to him empty, with nothing in them. And so raising the hand is, again, from the established adab of dua. Similarly, that which is present within the hadith is the fact that the man made al-azam in his dua. That is, he was firm, he had firm resolve when he supplicated. For indeed, the Prophet ﷺ likewise commanded that you should not say, Allahumma irhamni in shi't, Allahumma ghfirli in shi't, wal ya'zim al-mas'ala. He said that you should not say, oh Allah, when you supplicate, that you should not say, oh Allah, forgive me if you wish, forgive me if you will. Rather, you should be firm in your asking. That is, you should say, oh Allah, forgive me. Oh Allah, overlook me. Oh Allah, bless me. And you should not say, oh Allah, if you will, if you wish, please forgive me. Rather, you should be firm in your manner of supplicating. And that is not that a person has bad adab with Allah Azza wa Jal, but it is from the adab of dua. For indeed, Allah Azza wa Jal will give to whomsoever He wills, and He'll prevent from whomsoever He wills. And so you're using particular types of speech won't change that which Allah Azza wa Jal will give to you in relation to responding to your dua. The Prophet ﷺ said, فَلْيَعْزِمَ الْمَسْأَلَةَ. Rather, he should be firm when he asks. And we hear and we see that the man, in his manner of supplicating, Ya Rab, Ya Rab, oh my Lord, oh my Lord. This affair of repeating the dua is likewise from the adab of the dua. Similarly, from that which was present within the dua of this man, that he called upon Allah Azza wa Jal using the names and the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal, which is from the adab and the mannerisms of dua. That if a person is asking Allah Azza wa Jal for something, then he asks by way of one of the names or the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal, or the names of Allah that is relative to his request. If he's seeking forgiveness, then he asks by way of the names of Allah that return back to forgiveness and mercy. Ya Ar-Rahman, Ya Ar-Rahim, Ya Al-Ghafoor. Those names that return back to mercy and forgiveness. If he's asking for something from the dunya, then he asks Allah Azza wa Jal by way of those names that relate to Allah Azza wa Jal being the bestower of bounties. Ya Al-Wahhab. Allah being the sustainer and the one that provides provisions. Ya Razak, for example. So here, the man asks Allah by way of one of his names. Ya Rab, Ya Rab. So this combination of that which is present within the hadith and that which is present within his dua is imperative for us to reflect upon and consider all of the, or many of the aspects of the accepted dua that were present within the dua of this man. But what was it that the Prophet ﷺ said concerning his dua, him and his dua? مَطْعَمُهُ حَرَامُ مَشْرَبُهُ حَرَامُ ملبسه حرام غذي بالحرام فأنا يستجاب له. He said his food is haram, his drink is haram, his garments are haram, he is nourished by way of that which is haram. How then is his dua going to be accepted? And that, no doubt, ikhwan, is a strong message to each and every one of us in relation to that which we feed ourselves and our families with. A strong message in relation to that which we give as sadaqah and in charity. Vitally important, ikhwan. And we oftentimes hear brothers and sisters saying that they make dua and Allah doesn't seem to respond to the dua. First and foremost, we should be patient when we make dua, that our supplication isn't necessarily going to be responded to immediately. Allah Azza wa Jalla will respond in accordance with His wisdom and His hikmah. And it may be that a person supplicates today and the response to that supplication is 5-10 years down the line, 20 years even. Scholars of tafsir, they mention concerning Zakariya alayhi salatu wassalam. Now when Zakariya, as occurs in Surah Ali Imran, when Zakariya saw the food that was being given, or that Maryam received alayhi salam, that she received the food of the winter and the summer, the food of summer and winter, he said to her, "Where have you gotten this from?" And so she said that indeed Allah Azza wa Jal has given it to me, has provided it for me. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَرْزُقُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. That indeed Allah gives to whomsoever He wills without measure. And so based on that, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions, هُنَالِكَ دَعَى زَكَرِيَّا رَبَّهُ. Here Zakariya made dua to his Lord. And based on that, it is as though Zakariya was, or he took benefit from what he saw occurring with Maryam. Of course, the prophets and the messengers, they know best that Allah Azza wa Jal gives sustenance to whomsoever He wills, that Allah is the one to be asked, and so on. They know that best. But of course, the believer, he continues to benefit from that which he sees around him, and it causes him to draw closer and closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. So Allah mentions, هُنَالِكَ دَعَى زَكَرِيَّا رَبَّهُ. Upon that, Zakariya called upon his Lord, because Zakariya had no children. قَالَ رَبِّ هَبْ لِي مِن لَدُنْكَ وَذُرِّيَّةً طَيِّبَةً إِنَّكَ سَمِيعُ الدُّعَى. He said, "Oh my Lord, give me ذُرِّيَّةً طَيِّبَةً, give me goodly offspring, for indeed you are the one that hears the dua." Which indicates clearly that Zakariya knew, wasn't that Maryam was teaching him, Zakariya knew, إِنَّكَ سَمِيعُ الدُّعَى, indeed you are the one that hears the dua. Then Allah mentions, فَنَادَتْهُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَهُوَ قَائِمٌ يُصَلِّ فِي الْمِحْرَابِ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يُبَشِّرُكَ بِيَهْيَا مُصَدِّقًا بِكَلِمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَسَيِّدًا وَحَصُورًا وَنَبِيًّا مِّنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. But Allah said, when he was making dua, when he was making salah, that the malaika came to him and gave him the glad tidings of a child whose name will be Yahya, and who will bear witness to that which has come from Allah Azza wa Jal, will be a leader, and one that is chaste, and a prophet from among the righteous. Zakariya responded, أَنَّ يَكُونُ لِي غُلَامٌ وَقَدْ بَلَغَنِيَ الْكِبَرُ وَامْرَأَتِي عَاقِرٌ. He said, "How will I have a child when I have reached old age, and my wife is barren?" Here, the scholars mention why, the scholars of tafsir mentioned, why would Zakariya respond after asking Allah Azza wa Jalla for a child? When he's given the glad tidings of a child, he says, "How am I going to have a child after you just asked for one?" The scholars, they mention that Zakariya, when he first made dua, he was 60 years old. When the malaika came and gave him the glad tidings of a child, he was 90 years old. And so there was some 30 years between him making dua and between that dua being accepted. 30 years. Throughout the whole of that period, he was patient, and Allah Azza wa Jal saw from his wisdom that that was the time that he was going to grant the individual his dua. So one should not be hasty and impatient when we make dua. But we oftentimes hear people saying, I've made dua and Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't respond. And these are from the things that we need to evaluate within ourselves. How are we in relation to, number one, being patient upon making dua, and number two, how are we in relation to what we are consuming and how we are feeding ourselves and how we're clothing ourselves and our families? For indeed, eating, consuming, and clothing ourselves and our families with that which is not tayyib, and that which is haram, is from the clearest and the most categorical ways that our dua will not be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يوفقنا وإياكم لما يحبه ويرضاه وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.